Hi, thank you so much for having me here. Such a cool way of getting people from different disciplines, especially I'm from social sciences, to kind of talk about very important issues facing our society and how we can use interdisciplinary methods to kind of mitigate those issues. So just a little background on me before I start my presentation. So as I said earlier, my name's Anamika Burman Adhikari, and I'm an assistant professor in the School of Social Work at the University of Denver. And in terms of my research interest, I'm fascinated with the idea of social influence, and for the last 8 years, I have been trying to understand kind of why people cluster in social networks, both face-to-face and online, and kind of the psychological, sociological, cognitive, and mathematical rules that govern how these networks tend to operate. In terms of my talk today, I have to add one caveat before I even get into the presentation. I am not an AI expert. I'm a social scientist who has come to value and appreciate how AI can be used in the public health domain. And I'm gonna use one of our projects, which is known as Guide, to kind of showcase how interdisciplinary research, especially AI and public health and social work, can come together to solve a very important issue in the domain of behavioral sciences, and especially substance abuse prevention. So as I said earlier, I'm gonna talk about GUIDE, which is an acronym which stands for Group-Based Intervention Decision Aid for substance abuse prevention among homeless youth. But before I get into that, I think it would be useful to get a sense of the scope of substance abuse and homelessness among youth who experience homelessness in the United States. So in terms of the population and numbers, approximately 1.5 million youth are homeless in the US at any given point of the year, which might be surprising to a lot of you here, because the US is one of the richest countries in the world, but we still have stark levels of inequality. In terms of the rates of substance use among homeless youth, there are so many things that plague youth who experience homelessness, but substance abuse is especially problematic. So based on data collected in between 2011 to 2013 in Los Angeles from 1,000 homeless youth, what we found is that about a quarter of youth engage in either meth use or prescription drug misuse, and about 13 to 15% engage in heroin or injection drug use. And to put these numbers into context, why this is problematic, approximately 1% of youth, equivalently aged youth in the US who are housed and not homeless, engage in the same kind of drug use rate. So 1% versus 25%. That's pretty stark. So one of the reasons why I'm so interested in substance abuse is because it is a network-based phenomenon. So social influence is key to understanding why people engage in drug abuse. So this is a network map, and what you see here is 160 homeless youth who are connected to each other in a social space. And the blue dots are people, like all of the dots are people, and the lines are basically the relationships among them. And the blue nodes are people who engage, youth who engage in drug use. And the gray and white dots are people who don't engage in drug use. And what you'll see here is that really drug use is a public health phenomenon, right? All the drug users tend to cluster together, which is explained by classic social science theories, homophily, the notion that birds of the same feather flock together, and also social learning theory. If you're around people who engage in a behavior, guess what? You're more likely to engage in that behavior. So, however, the ironic thing is that in terms of preventing drug use, even though networks are implicated in why substance abuse happens, networks are also the key to preventing drug abuse. So what research has found that prevention programs are most effective when they have a peer component, because then people get to engage in drug refusal skills or drug resistance skills in their natural peer environment. So the way these peer network interventions have been designed is that people are usually assigned to groups based on random assignment without any knowledge of how they're connecting to their peers, or also you know, not an understanding of the social space where they're engaging in drug use. Or the other method that is used is that youth get to choose their own peer groups. And if you go back to the previous slide, what we saw is that peers tend to hang out with other peers who are like themselves. So, well, a lot of times what happens is that a lot of users come to get together, and that increases their drug use behavior, which is known by this term called deviancy training. And deviancy training is a problem in prevention science. It has been a sticky problem in prevention science ever since we have been trying to prevent drug abuse among any groups of youth. So in terms of the question we wanted to address, or the problem we wanted to address through our interdisciplinary collaboration, is how to assign people to groups based on their existing network relationships and also their substance use behaviors. And the way we saw how AI helped is that with AI, we wanted to understand whether we could have a predictive algorithm that could tell us whether or not, if we engage in that intervention, if deviancy training would be exacerbated, or if you could reduce deviancy training. So in the context of AI, we really saw this as a graph partitioning problem. So if you go back, you know, to the figure that I showed you earlier, what if we could design an algorithm that could reconfigure this network based on, you know, drug use and as well as pre-existing relationships in a way where we could optimize positive influence. So instead of like cutting these networks into clusters, we had to reconfigure people in a way that we could basically reduce the problem of deviancy training. So in order to do that, we thought we had to model three important parameters. And I'm going to talk about what parameters were included and not really the simulation techniques, and Phoebe is going to address that in her talk. But in terms of understanding why deviancy training happens and how to mitigate it, we thought there are three important modeling components that we needed to include in our algorithm. First is network influence, which I'm going to talk about. The second is network dynamic modeling, and third is interventionist modeling. So in terms of influence modeling, as Amulya was saying earlier, there are competing influences in networks. There, people are associated with a lot of people, and because of the diversity of these influences, there are both positive and negative influences on people. So the way we saw it is that it is a linear threshold model. So basically, people get, you know, both positive and negative influences from their peers, and if the influence signal crosses the threshold value, then the person is more likely to change their behavior. So for example, if a user is connected to more non-users than users, they're more likely to change their behavior. Also, because this intervention, the way we design social work interventions is that it happens over a period of time, and over that period of time, people change their behaviors and also their relationships, it was important for us to model how those relationships change. And what we hypothesize is that if a user became a non-user, they're probably more likely to strengthen their relationships with other non-users and weaken their relationships with other users. And that's something we also wanted to model in the algorithm. Also, there is the interventionist component. So in social work, usually interventions are delivered by professionals, and they are also a key component of the intervention. And we wanted to basically understand what kind of relationships the participants have with the interventionist and how that changes the nature of their behaviors as well as their networks. In terms of the results, what we found is that GUIDE outperforms the traditional status quo methods of random assignment and peer chosen groups by almost 40%. That's pretty huge, and that's statistically and practically meaningful. And what this emphasizes is that, you know, it's important to acknowledge existing relationships and network tie strength and behavior in understanding how we can minimize deviancy training. How GUIDE helps in the real world, we are planning to deploy this decision aid in a shelter in Denver, Colorado. And what we'll be able to do is to predict scenarios where deviancy training is increased, does, you know, saving time, money, and effort. Future strategies, real-world deployment that I talked about, we also need to make certain tweaks to our model to kind of include uncertainties, and we also need to make our model a little more complex because right now we are just modeling three things. We hope to model other behavioral parameters that might also, and demographic variables that might also impact substance abuse. So that concludes my presentation. I'll be happy to talk to you later or answer any questions you have right now. Thank you. Yes.
In homelessness and drug abuse, which way does causality flow?
So that's a great question. So substance abuse happens prior to people becoming homeless, and it could be a cause of homelessness as well. So a lot of people become homeless because they're substance users, and also because they have to survive in an environment where drug abuse is considered to be a survival skill. It could get exacerbated because of the circumstances they face after they experience homelessness. So it could be both. It's a chicken and egg thing.
Thank you.